Welcome everybody, you're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today we're going to deal with the unique constraint and indexes. Feel free as always to hit me up here on my socials if you need any help or have any suggestions. This is going to deal with unique index and constraint for existing databases. That's an important distinction, existing databases. Your constraint, you can use it on one or more columns. You're also dealing with the fact that you're not having repeat rows. You're trying to remove duplicates. Your null values are also considered not equal. If you want to deal with your null values, you need to put in this, nulls not distinct. Therefore, it's going to treat all your null values as equals. You could do this with multiple columns where your combination of rows cannot have combined values. This is going to be shown and illustrated for better understanding in some examples below. You also have two variations. You have a table constraint and a column constraint. They sound the same, but they're slightly different, and we'll see that later. You may ask yourself, well, how is this any different than a primary key? Scroll down a little bit. Your primary key can only be evaluated once for a given table. Also, null values are not allowed. If you're updating or deleting, that's not allowed with the primary key. You do have the option of doing an auto increment. Your indexes are considered clustered and your rows are unique. Whereas if you have the unique constraint on the right, you can prevent duplicates with this, but you could also have this on numerous columns or tables. Your null values are allowed and any update or deletions are allowed as well. In what case would you use one of these constraints? If you have something that's called often, for example, some columns during your queries, this is a good idea. Also, if you're using any kind of joins or where clause, this is a good option as well. Unfortunately, avoid using this if you have to update your columns often. If you have a small table, don't use this. There's a few reasons why. And if your columns are not used often, there's no use of you using this. And another consideration is the fact that inserts and updates do create overhead. Now, why would a small table or frequent updates be an issue? We're going to see that shortly. The unique index is a little different though. This is creating indexed columns, which are unique. It's really good for fast lookups, and it's typically by default using a B tree and trying to preserve or aiding in your data integrity. It's great if you need to subset a small number of rows for a given table. I would say that if you have a large number of rows and it could subset into something very small, it's a good use case. But if you end up doing a subset and it's a large number versus your actual table as your given result, don't use it. You need to pay attention to this. This is extremely important. You're creating a lock when you're writing operations if you're doing this index. This could become very problematic if you have a lot of data, and there's workarounds you need to do to avoid having this lock, such as doing the concurrently. This is the same thing. Small tables, avoid using this. If your table is very large, but your returned results is very large, avoid using this, because in both cases, it's better to do a sequential scan according to Postgres, which will figure this out on its own, instead of wasting the time to create your index and run the values through this. And if you have columns with large number of null values, don't add an index on this column. The next important thing, your input-output operations causes you an issue because you're wasting your time on this index if indeed you have a small table. This works as well for your constraint, or if you're having a large number of results returned. In that case, you're going to have a drastic slowdown for your index. Thereby, Postgres internally will decide to do a sequential scan instead, and either your index or your constraint will basically be dead, and you should probably get rid of those. There's artifacts that you need to pay attention to. This occurs because this table scan is performed in updating the index for each row. Now you're not able to do any updates because you're locking the table. So any updates, deletes, or inserts won't be performed while you have this lock. Like I said before, concurrently is used to avoid this lock. If you use this, there's a consideration because now you're performing two table scans instead of one. And you're also needing to wait for the build to happen for your index to occur. occur until the transactions are finished. When you're often updating, consider doing a re-indexing because of possible fragmentation, as well as if you have frequent deletes. Remember this, if you're often deleting or updating and you have an index, consider re-indexing because of fragmentation. And here's an interesting thought before we get into examples. If you have a multi-threading scenario, your constraint can have instances where your inserts or your deletes will access the same data at the same time, which will give issues for uniqueness. There's a scenario where you could have something called deferring, which you should probably look into. At the end of this video, I give two tips for people who are usually never going to see, but it'll help you out in the end. Now let's evaluate our first example where we're looking at a unique constraint with three scenarios. Like I said before, you have a column constraint, you have a table constraint, and then there's naming conventions you could do on your constraints or your indexes. The column constraint for this 1A will be right here, where we're creating this table where we have customer orders. We have a transaction ID, which is a primary key integer. We have a username, which is just some varchar, and it's a non-null. We have an order date, which is a date. We have quantity, which is integer, and we have order notes, which we could actually convert this into text if we wanted to instead. And at the end, we have a unique constraint built on that particular column. What is happening here? You're creating a column where you're having non-duplicated rows. The table constraint will have something very similar, and you'll have this parentheses notation calling the unique constraint. This, on the other hand, is slightly different. For instance, if we use multiple columns, it'll use a combination of rows, which are not unique, which means that we're going to see the distinction in a later example to clarify this further. In 1C, on the other hand, we decided to use constraint, create a unique name for the constraint, call the exact constraint we want on the specific table with the column of username. This is calling a table constraint on a unique column now of username. Another interesting side note, if you have not named a constraint, a primary key, some index, Postgres does an automatic naming convention. I'll explicitly show this in a second. If you have an existing table, you could add that constraint here. I decided to name it. We're using a unique constraint on this column, but we're creating a table constraint with this. If we needed to drop our constraint, for example, if you're having an issue where you needed to do a rollback, for example, this would be a good case where you want to drop that constraint. There's also considerations when you're doing a large amount of data for inserts, updates, deletions, for example, where it may be better to just remove the constraint, do your operations, and then put it at the end due to time sake or possible conflicts. It'd be great if you're doing maintenance also to reconsider that. The index, which we're creating for the fast lookups, when you're creating a constraint, it automatically creates that unique index, but the unique index is not creating a constraint. It doesn't work vice versa. So to repeat that, when you create your unique constraint, it is creating a unique index on the back end. So you'll do create unique index. Here's my unique index name, and it's on this particular table where I have this particular column of interest. If we wanted to show what indexes we have this option. This looks kind of goofy, but if you see these columns, this is a generic information you want as an output. So you're basically saying, hey, for all my tables, what are the index names and what is the definition for these index names? And you're using this parameter here, which is internal function in Postgres, pg_indexes. You're using where, you're pulling your schema for anything that's public, and you're ordering by the table name and the index name. And this is your result. Now here is what happens when you get the default naming convention where it's taking your column information and it's putting on, hey, this is a primary key, this is some kind of other constraint that we may have. This is what it looks like for the naming convention. By default, you're using a B tree. It'll tell you, hey, this is my primary key, for example. This is just some other kind of unique constraint that we have here. And if you notice, your primary constraint is a unique constraint, unique index. This is showing what's in our database. Next, we're going to look at what's in our current table. Current table is only this distinction here from above where we're saying, let's look at our index, the selected index, let's see the definition of our index, and let's use the function of the pg_indexes where we want some table with the name customer orders. And here's the printout here. A tricky example that we have is this. Assume that we're creating a country table example where we have some table with the country column, let's not null, consider text. The same thing for cities, but we want this to be unique, and we want the state to be not null and unique as well, and we have a population as integers. How is this going to work? And is there a situation where this does not pass for uniqueness? We're going to see that in a second. We have a next example where we're taking two columns, which are going to be a table constraint for this unique operation when we're creating this table. Everything from the above is the same, but what's really different for the output when we insert into this table? In the first example, if we inserted into the country of the United States with the city of Portland and the state of Oregon, we have a simple insert. We do this insert, but now we have the same city name, but we also have a different state. And we created a unique constraint on two different columns, but we did them separate. So each column cannot have a repeating row. And you're going to get an error because of this. So we have our unique constraint with this default naming convention here from Postgres, since we didn't name it, and we already have this existing key for Portland, the city of Portland. The way we get this workaround is using the table constraint that we had above, but we do them together instead of separate. It allows a combination of rows to be generated where each combination of rows will not have a repeating row. This will allow you to do the insert of Portland, Oregon, and Portland, Maine. Now here's the last little tip or tips that I have for you for basically anyone who decided to watch till the end, which is probably less than 0.1% of any viewers. You have two things. One, it's called deferring. If you defer a transaction, I'm not doing it in this video. I have some links. If you go on the GitHub, there's links for explaining this in examples. But it's good if you have a constraint or some kind of index and you want to postpone any of these reads till the very end of a transaction so you don't have conflicts for any kind of constraint, index, something was unique, something was duplicated, because you could have an error and it stops everything and then nothing else proceeds. So if you run everything to go first, then you run your checks at the end, you could free up your operations to perform and avoid some of the issues like if you have locks, if you have anything like that. Command line, you can do this and it'll output all of the indexes that you have in your current database, or you can run this with this D underscore table name, and that'll show you all your indexes, schema, keys, constraints, everything for that given table. But that'll be the end of this video. But feel free to like, share, and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. Here's my socials. Feel free to hit me up. It'd be great if you'd like to help support the channel with either super thanks, buy me a coffee, channel memberships. They're all greatly appreciated. It takes a lot of work to make these videos, even though they're not the best. But I'll see you in the next video. Bye.